and welcome to Association Transformation, our now more than 1 year old conversation, international, worldwide, coming to you from everywhere. Conversation advancing. Wait, what are you going to jump in and say? I know you're going to ruin my intro. You're going to ruin my intro, Andrew. God,
no,
you're gone for
that.
1 week.
I just want to know where you are this week, because you say international.
Oh my gosh.
And I know that you're not at home, so...
No, I'm coming to you live from a COVID hotspot, Florida, the lovely, beautiful southern state of Florida. I'm quarantined at the beach, healthy and safe, but avoiding as many humans as possible. So my connection to the world is podcasting. I'm excited to be here. I'm really excited. I don't know about you, but I'm an Olympics person, and I'm excited to talk about the Olympics. I'm excited to talk about, I don't know, putting it in an association nonprofit context. Is that crazy?
No,
you're
not at all.
Your
I mean,
eyes.
The Olympics.
I mean,
no, I'm not. The Olympics are happening. I think. Team GB is number 5 in the table, I think, at the moment. I'm looking at producer, Andy. Are they number 5? Yeah, excellent. Yeah.
I mean,
that's
Wales
number 6,
has a medal count of 0. I know Wales has a medal count of 0, but that's okay. It's only up from here. You guys have,
indeed.
It's only up from here.
Uh-huh.
No, but seriously, I thought this would be a great opportunity to chat about competencies. I mean, we're looking at the best of the best in the athletic world, and I don't know, it makes me think of what skill sets, what strengths, what abilities are the gold, silver, and bronze of association leadership. Yeah, I know it's cheesy. But you know, competencies are important.
I think it's good. Yeah, and I think it's timely as well, because I mean, as you know, we've been working on the, you know, we're currently working on the systems map or the competency framework for the Institute of Association Leadership, and this is at the forefront of my mind as well. We've been, I don't know, well, you've been sunning it down in Florida, I've been up to my eyeballs in sort of working through, you know, competencies, and it's interesting because as a bronze, I'm gonna give myself as a bronze chief executive, I'm thinking, you know, what could I have
bronze?
Done better? Yeah, what could I have done better to achieve a mediocre silver or even a gold? I don't know. But no, it is not. I like it. So go on, tell me what constitutes in your mind, what constitutes a gold chief executive?
You know, before we get to the good stuff, you've already interrupted and ruined the introduction. So let's take a step back. I'm Elisa Pratt with Brewer Pratt Solutions, your co-host. Not so glad to be rejoined by my colleague across the pond, Andrew Chamberlain from Consort Strategy. Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening.
Hi, how you doing?
You're such a jerk sometimes. But anyway, Association Transformation is our biweekly podcast. We're excited to be back with you. We're excited to be broadcasting on behalf of the Institute of Association Leadership. Let's jump into the topic with all of our sponsors thanked. I think those gold, silver, and bronze competencies have changed a lot in the last 5 years. You know, when I think of the soft skills and how much those, you know, the listening, the empathy, the team building components of that. And they sound fluffy and you know, 20 years ago, that on a list would be laughed out of the room. But the soft skills to me are, I don't know, they're becoming more and more important.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough. I think what we've seen over the last 5 years, in fact, I would argue even the last 18 months, we've seen the elevation of the chief executive role and of the leadership function of the association chief executive. I think, you know, back in the day when I started and when you started out in associations, it was recognized that the chief exec position was probably more of a perfunctory management role. Leadership wasn't really quite as wasn't really top of the list. It was understood that there was a function, but I don't think it stood out as being what I would now consider the primary role of the chief executive. You're right. I think 5 years ago, if I think back on what a job description looked like, maybe even 10 years ago, 5 years ago, it would have been very much the focus on that kind of Well, quasi chief operating officer, chief technical officer, chief financial officer role rather than
that to be
leadership.
The general, you know. It seems like in the past you needed to be the general. Now you need to be the chief inspiration officer. You need to be the chief engagement officer, the chief creative officer. I mean, you know, not only do we see the creation of these new C-suite names demonstrating to us in the for-profit world that these roles are taking shape and being given importance, you know, they're being validated. But, you know, it also makes me wonder if a gold, silver, bronze list is somewhat of a trap as well. I know we're working on this competency framework and it's such an extensive list and every organization needs something different. One organization may need a creative leader. The other organization may need someone who can manage risk. You know, every one of these strengths has a flip side.
Yeah, absolutely. And the reality is, I say this to associations all the time, you know, you can't be everything to everybody all the time. You'll end up pleasing nobody. And it's true of being a chief executive as well. You're right. Depending on the circumstances of the association, you may want a chief executive who is flamboyant in his or her creativity, is, you know, inspirational in their aspirations, just oozes ambition constantly and is out there developing business, developing relationships, being the face of the organization. Or you may want a more pragmatic individual who is more focused on behind the scenes, on shoring up and steadying the ship, on delivering, you know, considered, I don't want to say paced, but considered growth. So absolutely, you know, I think one of the things I've realized in the last couple of weeks as I've been building this, or as we've been building this rather, this framework, I'm looking at it thinking, actually, yeah, you can't be everything to everybody. No. But you can be, be the best at what you can be in the circumstance.
Be the best that you can be.
Oh my God! I know it sounds like I'm. Yeah, it sounds like some horrible Disney thing, doesn't it? Sorry, as I'm saying it, I thought.
It makes me think of the Karate Kid. Do you know that song from the Karate Kid at the end? You're the best around. You know when he wins the tournament. Okay, your homework is to go watch the Karate Kid tonight.
It's so long since I watched the Karate Kid. Yeah,
you have to go watch the Karate Kid tonight.
Paint the fence. I know all that.
Watch the Karate Kid tonight. That's your homework. Because I'm never going to sing again on our podcast, and your punishment is watching Karate Kid. Andy's very happy. I'm never going to sing again. But seriously, I think you're right. And it became, when we were doing the focus groups for the competency frameworks, everyone was just firing off different skills and strengths and leadership capacity and all. It became such a laundry list. And having now worked with several organizations on executive search and leadership transition, I too am worried that people will look at these lists as this is what a leader needs in full. And I think they have to be looked at as a menu. You know, you pick the things that you need for what your organization is, because the marketplace, the job market, we're already in some ways setting organizations up to think that they need a unicorn. And these unicorns don't exist.
Well, I'm not sure I agree that they don't exist. I mean, you know, I'm just looking in the mirror. No, I'm not sure I agree.
You're a bronze. You're a bronze, remember.
Oh, yeah, bronze unicorn.
You're a bronze unicorn.
I'm not sure I agree that, you know, we're setting them up to think that, you know, you have to be everything. I think what we are setting people up to understand is if you've not got these particular skills or competencies or you know, these particular characteristics of leadership, you at the very, very least need to understand and appreciate where to go to get the specialist advice or support that you may be, you know, that you may be missing. And I think, you know, that in itself, I think, is a significant skill to recognize and to be able to admit that you don't necessarily, you know, you're not the all seeing eye. You don't know everything about everybody, however much you might like to pretend otherwise, and goodness me knows I've done that enough. But you know, I think what we're trying to create here is a repository of skills, knowledge, behaviors, competencies, call it whatever you want, you know, the characteristics of leadership that, yeah, that certainly we should be using to guide how we perform, guide how we work. And for me, it's really all about how we lead. I'm really, really, I am excited, but I'm really keen that, you know, that over the next 12, 18, 24 months with this systems map, we're calling it, competency framework, you know, it's whatever language you use, it's the same thing. I want people to understand that we want to elevate the role of the chief executive, which isn't to say that the chief executive doesn't have to pull, you know, roll their sleeves up and get stuff done. Because of course they do. Of course they do. And that's, it would be foolhardy for us to suggest that, you know, I don't know, the night before the annual meeting, you're not going to be on your hands and knees putting up exhibition stands or whatever, you know, because again, we've all been there and done that. But that's not the core purpose. That's not the core purpose and the core function of the chief executive role. And that's what that's for me, that's the really important piece, is understanding that there'll always be somebody that we can call upon to provide us with those that support, but that isn't necessarily the case for everything that we do, particularly around the kind of the creativity piece and the business development piece, and you know, having that commercial acumen or the ability to maximize commercial opportunity. And I think in a non-profit world, one of the other things I've seen in the last couple of years is the use of language, and that we're starting to accept that even though we're not for profit, and you've heard me say this a million times, we're also not for loss. And so we're starting to see a much more corporate mindset in a positive, constructive way, reaching, you know, the very upper echelons of senior executives.
As these competencies and the outline take shape, I simply want there to be a prologue. I want there to be a clarification for those who are reading it, whether it be an aspiring executive, a current CEO, a board, to understand what it is, that this is an outline of aspirational skills and strengths. It's what you should be looking for. It's what you should be working towards in your own professional development. I just hate the idea of a board taking this full list and thinking this is their evaluation tool now.
I don't. Quite frankly, I think if you did get a board who was taking this, that would be, I think, a step in the right direction. Why shouldn't we expect our chief executives to have as many of these attributes as possible? I mean, we want success for our organizations.
Measuring and aspiring are different. And if I'm a chief executive and I'm looking at this list and I'm saying, okay, I check 8 of these 10 boxes, but I don't have certain areas, to me, I'm going to look to that for my own professional development, my own improvement and education, but I'm also going to look to that in my senior team. Okay, that tells me maybe I should hire in this area. I'm not the leader that believes I need to solely be the end-all be-all to my organization. I have staff around me. I have those I can hire for. And I think that self-awareness is as important as any skill set on that list. I need to understand my areas of shortcoming or the gap analysis as an organization that we may have to do to understand what skills are necessary in the senior team. I also don't want every single skill set to exist in one person. I want there to be, some securities and replications and organizational knowledge that lives in more than just one person.
Absolutely. But that is what we're doing in mapping this out, though, isn't it? Is we're saying, I mean, what we're not doing, we're not mapping every facet of association activity and attributing it to the chief executive or, you know, the C-suite. What we're saying is that there's a specific set of skills, expertise that you need, and you do need them, even if you come into the job and you don't have them. Ultimately, you do need them, regardless of what the current context of your current association is. The reality is we're all interested in what our career progression looks like, and ultimately I would argue most chief executives are looking to progress, you know, what's my next step, where do I need to improve, where do I need to enhance my expertise. And so, you know, ultimately I think you should be aiming to have what we've captured in this framework, because it is the chief executive leadership map. It's not the association leadership map. It is about the individual and the role that that individual must play. And it does recognize that. It does recognize that, absolutely, you're absolutely correct, that the chief executive can't do everything, and neither should they be expected to, and you're absolutely right. We need to make sure that we have a balance of skills and expertise in the organization, but that is one of the roles of the chief executive, is, you know, putting together that talent strategy that that allows them to articulate the skills and the expertise that they need throughout the organization. It's that type of, go on, interrupt me.
I know how it is standing in front of a board of directors when the outgoing executive has announced their departure, and you're talking to the board and you're saying, okay, what do we need in our next leader? And the person they describe usually first is a younger 2.0 version of the person they have now. And, you know, you have to remind them that's not likely. Then you start with more of a blank slate, and you let them ideate and list off the skills that they believe they need to lead the organization. And it becomes this laundry list of an impossible unicorn person. And I'm hoping and I believe that this competency will give structure to those conversations. Yes, I'm excited about it.
Yes.
I'm excited about it supplementing things that already exist in kind of the ASAE world. Because it is chief executive focused, because it is internationally minded, and because it's for executives by executives. That's what I believe the IAL's competency framework will be and contribute, and how it'll be different and why I'm excited about it. I want it to be used by executive search firms. I want it to be used by boards. Yes. I want it to be used by executives in their own professional development aspirations, because it will be different. Yeah. But you know, right now, there's a lot of boards out there who are saying goodbye to long tenured executives, and the person they think they need does not exist in the marketplace, or they can never in their wildest dreams afford them. And it becomes a serious challenge of managing expectations in the search capacity.
Tell me again, though, why don't they exist? I don't understand. Why don't they exist? Why would these people not exist? Well, if they're looking for 2.0, where are those people?
I mentioned, okay, maybe I'm 8 out of 10. We're really creating a list of more than 10. You know, how many buckets does the framework currently have?
9.
Oh, 10. So you're disproving my point. Damn you.
But within those nine buckets, there is a lot of...
Think of it like online dating. You know, you create your perfect profile of your perfect mate, you check all these things off, and you've created such an impossibly perfect person that they likely don't exist. And I just don't want to set boards up for disappointment. I don't want to set that person they do finally find up to be, you know, a second choice or a bronze medal alternative. You know,
thanks very much for that, by the way. what you do want to do is to set people up and say, well, actually, do you know what? This person is not our gold winner, is not our gold medalist at the moment, using the Olympic theme that we seem to have forgotten about in the last 10 minutes. But all right, they're not our gold person, but actually they are our silver. And all we need to do is invest in X, Y, and Z in them, and they are going to be gold. And so that's what this is about. And actually, you know, I'm beyond worrying about boards not being able to, you know, quite frankly, I'm worried the boards are going to... Well, I don't even know how to say this diplomatically. I don't want boards to opt for second best. I don't want that. I want boards to aspire to have the possible best chief executive that they have, that they can possibly secure for themselves. They have a responsibility to the organization, to the association for that. They have a responsibility to the membership, to the staff. They have a responsibility to themselves as the board. Why would you not want to go out and seek the best person?
Of course you want that. Of course you're going to pursue that search and carry yourself with those expectations and those goals. But, you know, there are realities to factor into this. The marketplace is quite odd at the moment. And I think in a few podcasts, we're going to be joined by, you know, someone from that executive search field who can let us know how dramatically things have changed. You also have the realities of budget. You also have, I mean, there are things that are not in the organization's control and that you have to make the best decision given what you have to work with at the moment. I think the real opportunity here is aspiring CEOs. Whether they're internal, whether they are, you know, this isn't just lateral. You become an executive here. You move to become an executive here. I think this framework and defining these competencies is most exciting for the next generation of CEOs.
Definitely.
For those aspiring executives who already exist and can be invested in certain tactical ways and strategic ways to become that unicorn. If you look at this now and you say, okay, hey, I am a bronze right now, or I'm a gold senior VP, what would it take for me to become a unicorn executive? You have that list in front of you. I think that's how you build to it. Instead of finding them organically, you build to it. That's where you get exciting.
And I think probably perhaps arguably more important, or certainly as important as listing those competencies, is also part of the IAL's framework, is that we're actually going to be signposting people to where they can get that support, that advice, that guidance, that training, that professional development. You know, so I think for me, that's also the critical piece, is you can't just tell people, hey, go out there and, you know, understand how to give staff autonomy and decision making, right? Okay, well, what does that mean? You know, it's like, that's all well and good. So we need people to understand how to do things, not just that they need to do things. And so for me as well, I think it's really important that, you know, the systems map is going to direct users to those additional sources of support and guidance delivered by, as you say, you know, the ASAE, the CSAE, you know, the Aussies, the AUSAE, you know, our colleagues in Kenya, the African Society. You know, there's a ton of resources out there, and I think what's lovely about the exercise that we're conducting right now is that this is going to sort of pull it all together, so that when I am thinking about my career trajectory as an aspiring chief executive, all right, okay, maybe I don't want to do it for a couple of years, but I do know that when I am ready to do it, this is what I'm gonna have to invest my time and effort in learning or developing. So for me, that's a very exciting prospect as well.
No, I'm excited too. And, you know, having been on the front end of it with the focus groups, I love that it's for executives by executives. Yeah, sorry, hold on. I've got to see what the score is right now in the USA match.
Oh my God, are you watching the TV while we're recording a podcast?
We're talking about the Olympics. I'm being inspired by the content at the moment. I've been listening to everything you keep going on and on about. It's fine.
All right. Just take us home then. Take us home.
Oh my God. Are you pouting? Are you pouting?
I am a wee bit. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I was paying attention to you, listener. I was paying attention to you.
You were not. You were waiting for your time to speak. Oh goodness. Well, okay. I it's great to have you back. Obviously our chemistry is right back on track, right where we left off.
Yeah.
For the good of associations, we are happy and excited to be back and talking about these topics that I believe advance the skills, the leadership, and the leaders of nonprofit organizations. And association transformation will continue to push forth despite Andrew's emotional outbursts.
Thanks, Lise. Thanks. I should say as well that the systems map, I keep calling it competency framework, and that's not its official title. The official title is the IAL systems map. That is going to be available for members from the start of September. So okay, it's probably exciting. Worth letting people know that, actually. We've spent long enough talking about it. So, yeah, if you visit theial.org from the start of September, then all that information will be up there and you'll be able to access the map and start planning your professional development and your career next steps. And
very
quite
exciting.
Frankly, after the way I've been spoken to today, I also am going to be looking at my options post-podcast.
Well, I hope if nothing else, you now know that you have 4 years to advance yourself from bronze to gold. I want to see what you can do. I'm excited to see how improved you are 4 years from now.
Thanks.
And,
thanks. It's going to take a lot of drugs. It's going to take a lot of steroids, something to get me there.
The Wales Olympic Committee. You're going to be banned, and then you'll get to come back.
You do know that we compete as Team GB. You do know that, don't you?
You do? Well, that's not fair.
Yeah. Great Britain is Wales, England, Scotland, and Northern Ireland.
You just ride their coattails? What's happening?
I know Andy now is like, Andy, just cut her off. Just stop this. Just cut her off, please.
Oh, goodness. All right. Well, you know, good luck to everyone's countries. We have how many more weeks of Olympics do we have? Andy, when did the Olympics wrap? 2 weeks? 2 more weeks? Okay. So when this airs, maybe 1 more week to go or a week and a half. Exciting. Enjoy your Olympics watching and stay healthy and safe wherever you are. And while you're quarantined or wrapping up your summer vacations, we encourage you to find Association Transformation wherever you get your podcast. Marcus is your favorites. And be sure to email us or reach out to Andrew and I via LinkedIn with topic ideas or if you'd like to be a guest. We want to keep pushing forward with fun and engaging association and nonprofit specific topics. And until next time. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, Andy, for joining me today. And we'll say stay well and put your members and your mission first.
Association Transformation is brought to you in partnership between Consult Strategy and Brewer Pratt Solutions in support of the Institute of Association Leadership.